Thank you very much. I have, first of all, a question for all the panelists. It's about the equity issue and the decisional process. How did you decide? Did you decide from both sides, so government and the donor, about who won the lottery? This is number one, and then to define the priority of investment, and then which mechanism, practical investment, then they were put in place if the process was successful to expand to other community. Then I have another question for Mr. Fantozzi. You mentioned the landscape approach and the CGR. If I'm right, the CGR also advocate and has been testing, verifying the watershed approach. What are the practical relationship or difference among the two? Thanks.
Thank you very much. My name is Sheikh Sourang from IFAD. These are very interesting illustration of landscape, of territorial approach. My question is this: has there been, or is there now, any reflection on how to make these various initiatives adapt, either in the same countries or across countries, in terms of replication where socio-economic and geographical conditions are the same, adaptation where there are differences, in such a way that these adapt to reach more people over time. And linked to that, the other question is, before, as they were starting these initiatives, either from scratch or on the basis of something that was there already, without trying to predict the future, because that's not the question, but was there any sort of scale objective that was set in terms of the target, and what were the kind of process indicators and results indicators in terms of output, outcomes, etc., and how do they go about adjusting in light of implementation?
French Development Agency, Aurélie Chevrillon.
To know whether you think that this landscape approach could be supported or integrated into the first example that we had. It's a project that supports the decentralization process. And do you think that those two distinctive approaches of the territory can be crossed?
Julian Korn from NRI. I'd like to ask Madame Marie Madeleine from Cameroon if she has any comments on engagement with the private sector in the territorial process at district level planning in Cameroon in particular. Perhaps, I don't know, the cocoa sector, the mining sector, if there's any engagement on that side. And I wonder if Giuseppe Fantozzi from the bank has any comments on the institutional dimensions of the landscape projects that you mentioned, if there is any perspective of longer term engagement with local regional government from the point of view of consolidating sustainable economic development of these regions, or if the approach is basically one so far of environmental management plus productive support. Thank you.
Thank you. Giuseppe, let's start with you. There was a question around how landscape approaches compare with watershed approaches, question around who wins the lottery, a priority of investment, and a particular question to you around this institutional dimensions. Yes, just.
Does this work? Yep. Okay, the first with the watershed differences. There are no major differences. The watershed, I would say the landscape is more comprehensive than the watershed approaches. But particularly in the case of the Loess Plateau, the base was that the watershed approach, the most widespread and the same that is promoted by the CGIAR. The second was question was about landscape and decentralized approach. I have to say that I have seen different type of projects, some of which, again, following the landscape approach, some of which they all paid attention clearly to have a participatory approach, but some of them having more, giving more importance to decentralization from, and then I connect to the third question from an institutional point of view, as some of less. Now, to draw a lesson out of it is, I find myself I'm not able to draw a lesson right now at this stage, but I would like to say that at least my position that's for sure a landscape approach, given the fact that is having as one of his points of strength the fact that is differently probably from other actors, from other donors, the fact that we intervene into the governance aspects, the legal and the regulatory. My answer would be that, first of all, yes, should take into consideration always the decentralized institutions, and also the international dimension of landscape. From my answer, probably you know what is my position, that it should move and scale up into a, but today, being very honest, and particularly for that project, I think is still an environmental plus.
Thank you, thank you. Next question to Madame Marie-Madeleine Gah. What about the engagement with the private sector, and what are the synergies with landscape approaches with your example?
Ce que je vais déjà dire, c'est que qui a gagné le gros lot, mais en fait, je crois qu'il faut que définitivement, on entre dans le bottom-up et qu'on sorte du top-down, que ce soit le gouvernement, que ce soit les bailleurs de fonds, et que définitivement, on prenne en compte cette, j'allais dire, ce tiers acteur qui est le bénéficiaire en définitive. Et c'est ce que nous faisons, et je pense qu'aujourd'hui, le bénéficiaire est partie prenante dans la mesure où il exprime ses besoins à travers du plan, au travers du plan communal de développement, et qui devient le lieu consensuel des interventions des uns et des autres. Donc, c'est de lui qu'il s'agit. Il ne s'agit pas en premier lieu du bailleur de fonds ou du gouvernement. Donc, je pense que ça je crois que c'est ce que nous retenons du processus que nous sommes en train de mettre en place au Cameroun au travers de ce programme. Alors, la question du privé, la question du privé, elle est fondamentale au moment où il est question que toutes les parties prenantes interfèrent dans le développement territorial. Et à ce moment-là, déjà au niveau national, le gouvernement du Cameroun a une politique en place désormais à travers donc, le CARPAD qui essaie d'encourager, d'initier, d'impulser le partenariat entre le secteur public et le secteur privé. Et une déclinaison également avec les communes. C'est-à-dire que les communes peuvent également avoir des contrats ou des partenariats avec des privés selon les potentialités qui sont dans leurs communes. Et il faut dire une chose également, c'est que l'intercommunalité doit également être un axe à éprouver au travers de ces partenariats. Parce qu'une commune, à elle toute seule, c'est vrai, il y a des questions qu'elle doit déployer, mais il y a également des questions qui sont un ensemble de questions par rapport à une approche collective au niveau de l'intercommunalité. Donc, effectivement, pour répondre, c'est oui, le privé est associé dans cette démarche d'économie locale dont je parlais tantôt à travers donc la diversification des activités. Bon, je ne sais pas si j'aurai encore l'occasion de parler, sinon je voulais aller dans d'autres questions qui étaient dans comment coupler donc l'appui à la décentralisation avec les approches paysages. Ce que je dirais, nous avons parlé tout à l'heure de l'appui en termes d'investissement, d'équipement, j'allais dire. Nous avons apporté dans les équipements, je ne l'ai pas cité, en plus des ordinateurs ou des motos, des GPS. Des GPS que nous avons apportés aux communes et qui leur permettent effectivement de connaître un peu mieux leur territoire. Également, nous avons entrepris, à côté du plan communal de développement, des plans d'aménagement du territoire. Les plans d'aménagement du territoire, nous n'avons pas encore avancé. Nous avons déjà un certain nombre de communes et nous comptons aller de l'avant pour que ces communes puissent disposer d'un outil qui leur permet également de mieux se déployer en termes de capacité à mieux connaître donc leur territoire. Donc, je crois que ça se rapproche de ce que j'ai compris tout à l'heure en termes d'approche du paysage. Donc, voilà les choses que je peux dire en disant tout simplement que, pour nous, le plan communal est le soubassement qui permet aux acteurs, même à la base, de mieux comprendre, parce qu'on a parlé ce matin de mieux comprendre. Les acteurs à la base, eux-mêmes, ont besoin de mieux comprendre. Nous avons eu un projet au Cameroun avec la coopération hollandaise, le Scanwater. C'est un projet d'hydraulique rurale où, effectivement, le Scanwater, on a fait des adductions d'eau dans l'ensemble du territoire et ces adductions d'eau ont été abandonnées parce que c'était la manne qui est tombée du ciel. Mais au jour d'aujourd'hui, au travers de la participation et de l'appropriation donc du processus, ces populations, effectivement, se sentent concernées et ils ont participé à l'identification. Ils sont propriétaires parce qu'ils ont cofinancé, comme on disait tout à l'heure, l'exécution du micro-projet. Et ça leur appartient et ils se sentent concernés et c'est leur micro-projet. Donc, pour dire que ce sont des processus qui apportent même, en fait, un changement d'attitude, un changement de mentalité et qui ont donc la peau dure parce que ça devient des processus longs. Et il faut en tenir compte et nous sommes engagés là-dedans. Moi, je pense qu'il faudrait qu'on continue dans ce sens-là. Et je voudrais dire que nous allons mettre à disposition de tous ceux qui veulent en savoir un peu plus. Lors de cet après-midi, il y aura le dessin. Donc, nous allons mettre à disposition les documents qui peuvent donner un plus d'informations sur le PNDP.
Mark, could I ask you to talk to this concept of scaling up? Jake introduced you. How can you adapt these approaches to scale?
Okay. The projects we usually engage in are a follow-up on demands from our partner countries, requests for that. And these are usually negotiated and then designed in joint design missions locally, and then implemented locally with certain process tools that we have in GIZ developed over many years, some of which might be very well known under certain names. But the problem then is after we've developed a project and implemented it, we often would like to expand it to other areas. And this then depends on our local partners, but also in other countries. And that's where we see that often this demand is not there, that there are other thematic areas which are of higher priority, both in the bilateral negotiations between countries that they might prefer other themes, and coastal zone management, for example, in our case, just what I was presenting, is often not of a higher priority compared to others. It has been in the past that the topic of climate change in the coastal zone because of sea level rise, climatic impacts, tsunamis, etc., that this topic has come up again. But interestingly, that funding often comes from the environmental ministry, etc., but then we implement our tools and so forth. The upscaling is something we would like to pursue much more, but it's there also a matter of funding and demands and requests from the partner countries.
I will pick this up from Mauro, how we facilitate the dialogue at the local level and which issue we should be picking up for window device. As Shia said, or also other donors, we are taking a very much participatory approach. So first of all is to assist the local communities, the local government, to develop participatory local development plans and budget, where we also have to see that it's really a participatory process, that all the different people are inside. You have representatives not only from the public sector, but also from the private sector, from the research sites, extension sites, from the farmers, the most vulnerable people, which are often left out. It's a quite complex and intensive process, but it... It's primarily based, of course, it's a local decision, and we cannot say yes or no because we can't take local ownership very serious. So the only issue is when it's a very issue which we think there will be a negative environmental impact, or will we have a huge social negative impact, that we will say no. There's, of course, the matter of compensation, yeah, but actually how to deal with it. You have to make a decision, you have to look at the different trade-off, but to be frankly, we don't pay compensation at the time being. We're thinking about it, but It's a very difficult also to address, and also difficult to address with the local authorities, which are our main partners, because for them it's their priorities, and if the donor is supporting it, it's okay. So they don't really want to think about it, and we also have to more put emphasis more in a political dialogue at the local level, but also the national level, to talk about compensations.
For sure, I mean, this is exactly what I would have said about who is winning the lottery. I mean, I cannot tell you who is winning the lottery. I mean, that depends from the government, pipeline, other donors, how they identified, poverty mapping, whatever. What it's important for me to tell you now is who cannot win the lottery, at least who cannot win the lottery in having a project follow landscape approach. This is not just a nexus among natural capital resources, forest with land. If there is not an element, a distorting element of the people living in that country, the social element, that is creating a disincentive and is creating an environmental problem, and when that nexus can be broken with a set of investment, but again, legal and regulatory intervention, that's the project for the landscape approach. So if it's just a land and water issue without the social element or whatever, that cannot win the lottery in that sense.
Alphonse est le responsable, Boyogeno est le responsable national du suivi évaluation. Il y avait une question sur les indicateurs. Est-ce qu'on a des indicateurs et comment on peut les reprendre? Pour l'extension, nous avons étendu le programme à l'ensemble des régions parce qu'on a vu que ça se passait bien dans la phase d'initiation.
Ah, d'accord, ok. Merci, merci beaucoup. Je suis Alphonse Bourguin, comme Madame le coordinateur vient de dire. Bien sûr qu'on a les indicateurs. Le programme a un cadre de résultats qui a défini l'indicateur d'abord pour mesurer l'objectif de développement du programme qui permet de voir comment le niveau d'amélioration des conditions de vie s'effectue dans les communes que nous couvrons. Donc cet indicateur permet de voir le taux de couverture des services sociaux de base, comme Madame l'a indiqué. On a montré quelques exemples sur le tableau, les exemples de points d'eau, les exemples de points de santé, les exemples d'accès aux routes de bonne qualité. Et on a maintenant les indicateurs qui sont des indicateurs intermédiaires qui permettent de mesurer l'exécution des activités. Donc les indicateurs existent dans un cadre de résultats que nous suivons avec nos partenaires, l'AFD, la Banque mondiale et les autres.